Well, I'm excited today because we're entering into an amazing phase of Christianity, really. We know it's not the actual date, but it's a really exciting time, isn't it, to remember again everything that Jesus has done for us. And it's a good thing, isn't it? How many people are glad that Jesus paid the price and today we can be free? And anybody here ever been healed? Anybody here ever been blessed? Come on, come on. Anybody here ever been really, 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 really blessed? Come on. How about we give him thanks? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for coming and paying the price. Thank you for doing everything that you've done for us, and for that we give you all the praise. Amen. Last week I shared about Jesus, the Son of God, and I just want to just quote one scripture here. Luke 23, verse 46 from last week. And this is what he said. He said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last. He also cried out, "It is finished." And what he was really saying there is, my earthly ministry is finished. He had fulfilled the requirement of the law. Now, Jesus was no longer the Son of Man, but he was the Son of God. He took up his position by the right hand of his Father. And now he's there interceding for you and me. Today, he ministers out of his lordship, out of his position as one of the Godhead. And I believe today that he's interceding for Australia. He's interceding for the Sunshine Coast. He's interceding for a move of the Spirit of God. And I believe he's looking for hungry people. How many people are getting hungry for a move of God? True, come on. How many people are really getting hungry and want to see them all? Want to enter into something? And this morning, I want to pray and I want to believe God that we just can do that. Amen? I want to speak this morning about believe and receive. Turn to somebody and say, believe and receive. In Luke 8:50 and also in Mark 5:35 through to 42, the same story is told. And Jesus speaks these words. He says, "Do not be afraid, only believe, and she will be made well." So simple a word, yet so profound. So just a little phrase. Don't be afraid, only believe, and she will be made well. Peter, James, and John with Jairus and his wife go into a room or into a position or into an atmosphere where there's a dead girl. A dead girl lays there. And Jesus just says, "Don't be afraid, only believe, and she'll be made well." Father, I'm asking you this morning that you will break through. We were singing a song about you opened up that sea, that we could walk right through it. And I pray, my God, this morning that every obstacle to faith, every obstacle that would stand in front of us from reaching that place that you want us to enter into, my God, would be open wide and that we can walk right through it into the everlasting arms, into the promises, into the atmosphere, into everything that you said is ours. And devil, hell will have to freeze over until we stop speaking what God says we can have in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Open our eyes, Lord. Open our eyes to the supernatural. The natural thinking. As these people were there, as they looked at the situation, they would have had to say, "Hey, you got it wrong. She's dead. You've got it wrong. This kid's not alive. She's dead." And so I think every one of us have to go through different obstacles. I want to just share some things here that I want you to write into your heart, not into another book or into a book of notes or something like that, but write some things in your heart so that when we go through something, that these words will spring up. God will bring back to our remembrance things that we've written into our hearts. Believe the unbelievable and receive the impossible. God wants us to believe the unbelievable and receive the impossible. Everything God ever asks us to believe is unbelievable. You better get this straight. If it was believable, he wouldn't ask us to do it. But everything he ever asks us to believe is unbelievable. Peter, James, and John, with the parents of a dead child, enter everything inside them would have been screaming out. Their emotions would have been screaming out. Fear, most of it would have gripped their hearts. It would have been screaming at them. This beautiful child, this beautiful daughter is dead. And Jesus just turns around and says, don't fear, only believe. The simplicity of the Word of God, and yet the words that Jesus spoke, if we can identify with this, if we can somehow or other capture the whole concept, the words that Jesus spoke were not just idle words. They were impregnated with the power of God. And every promise that God ever speaks is impregnated with the Godhead, with the impossible, with everything, that if somehow or other we can harness ourselves to the Word and believe the Word of God, all things are possible. Not because of our ability, but because the Word that God spoke carried the anointing, carried the victory. And here they are, they're in a situation. Fear is the great destroyer of our faith. But there's another thing that is just as dangerous. It's called logic and reasoning. It also will destroy the Word of God in you, in me. Fear will destroy faith for sure, but also logic and reasoning. And it's so very, very easy to start to reason. But I find that when I get into a story in the Bible, that I've got to somehow or other try to put myself in that position. And Jesus walked into a circumstance, into a situation of total unbelief, total negativity, total failure. He wasn't walking into some charismatic, on fire, alive atmosphere of a church and spoke those words, don't fear, only believe, it'll be okay. No, I want to tell you, the Word of God will work no matter where it is applied if you somehow or other grab hold of it. He's walking into a total unbelief, chaos, negativity, failure, murmuring, complaining, goodness knows what. The professional mourners are all there. The wailers are there. All the negative families there. Everybody's there. But praise God, Jesus was there. And what we've got to somehow or other comprehend is no matter what you're going through, Jesus will go through it with you, and he will split open the sea, amen, that you can, if you grab hold of it, walk right through it. How many people know that God wants us to walk through some stuff that has really stopped us from going anywhere for years? I don't care how hard it is. I don't care how case-hardened it is, that if somehow or other we can allow the presence of God to get on the inside of us, that he will take us through every difficult thing and we'll come out the other side, amen. Because God wants to prepare a table for you and for me in the midst of our enemies, hallelujah. Jesus didn't walk into some you know, presence conference and say those words. No, you've got to see what he walks into. But he knew what he was carrying. Someday, you also will have to walk into some circumstances where everything around you looks dead. Everything around you looks like it's impossible. Everything around you looks like it's over, finished. But I want to tell you, it is not over until God says it's over. And the day that He says it's over, we'll hear a trump of God cry out and we'll see Him coming to receive us in glory. Hallelujah. And until He comes back, it is not over. Hallelujah. He is going to raise up a church, a triumphant church, a victorious church, a church who will walk right through it. Amen. A church that somehow or other believes Him. And in the midst of chaos, in the midst of negativity, in the midst of failure, you'll hear a word. You'll hear a word from God, and that word from God will carry the life. Everybody say life. Will carry the life that will make you free if you can just believe. Everything God asks us to believe is unbelievable. Everything He wants us to receive is impossible. Isn't that amazing? In fact, everything from Genesis to Revelation, all His teachings, all His promises, even Christ's birth, death, and resurrection all go beyond natural thinking. Your natural thinker is one of your worst enemies. When God says this, your natural thinker comes in and tries to cut it off at the pass. Natural thinking will destroy you. Everything about God is and asks us to do is impossible. That's why it's called faith. Faith in God. You see, we don't serve a religion. We serve a risen Christ who's alive today, amen. He's not on the cross. He's not hanging on that cross anymore. He's not in the tomb. He's not at Hades. He's risen. Praise God. Amen. We're not bound by natural things. We're not bound by natural things, ordinary thinking, because we've been born again. We are new creatures. Amen. We're new creation people. As when I was a child, that's how I lived, but now I'm a man. Once I was lost, but now I'm found. When I was lost, I thought as a natural man. And everything was according to me and my ability. But now I'm born again. I think as a born again man. And nothing is impossible. And nothing is too hard for God. Amen. Nothing. Nothing. We are continually, somebody say continually, learning from an extraordinary God. How many people are still learning? Come on. Are you still learning new truths? Isn't it great when you find a new truth? Amen. Isn't it great when all of a sudden, you know, you might, and all of a sudden you find a new truth and you think, amen, I don't have to do that. I can just receive that, praise God, and you receive it, and all of a sudden things start happening. Truth. So the Bible says, you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. God is bigger and more powerful than we could ever imagine. See, I don't know about you, but we all imagine what God's like. Well, can I tell you what? He's a million, billion, trillion times bigger than that. Amen? You should have got excited about that. God is bigger than you could ever, ever think, that you could ever, ever imagine. The Bible, let me have a look with you in the book of Ephesians chapter 3. You got your Bibles with you? Ephesians chapter 3. Just got to have a look where it is again now. 20. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think. Now listen to this. According to the power that works where? In us. According to the power that works in us. I want to talk a little bit later on about the in us. Amen? The in us. In us. What you've got on the inside of us. He's bigger than your wildest imagination. Your wildest imagination is only a speck to who he really is. Now, under him who is able, he is able to do awesome things. His word is stronger and mightier than you're ever, ever able to grasp. We will continually be learning about the word of God. We will continually be learning new truths. We will continually be having revelation and understanding of the magnitude, the majesty, the love, the purpose, the plan, what God has laid out for us, that we can just come again and again and again and get refreshed and get encouraged and go further and further and deeper and deeper. I've said it a few times. Enoch was a man that loved God, and he kept learning and learning and learning and learning and getting more and more and more in love with God until he got so far out there, he just didn't come back. How did you like that? Because, friend, I want to tell you, there's more and there's more and there's more. The moment that you think you've arrived, man, that's the end of you. But when you're looking for the more, God will open the more to you. He will be the revealer of truth, amen. He's going to reveal stuff. I want to tell you, there's so much more that God has made available to the church. And I don't know about you, but I've got a passion and I've got a hunger and I've got something on the inside of me that wants to see the more, hallelujah. I want to see the church triumphing, amen. I want to see when God delivered the children of Israel out of Egypt, there was not one weak or sick among them. There was no lack. There was everything that they needed, everything. They had the finances, they had sheep, they had everything that they ever needed. Their clothes never wore out. Some of you ladies mightn't like that idea, but praise God, a lot of the men would. There's more. Turn to somebody and say, there's more. And the word is stronger and mightier. For the word of God is living. Everybody say living. And powerful. Say powerful. And sharper than any two-edged sword. Piercing even to the division of soul and spirit. I really would love to really, really study this, the dividing of the soul and the spirit. I think it's the dividing of the natural and the spiritual. Amen? How many know that we need a division against that? Do you believe that? And of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intent of the heart. Let me read it again to you. For the word of God is living. That's amazing, amen? It's not just it's alive, hallelujah, amen? It'll bring life to you. And it is powerful. And it is sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow. And it is the discerner of the thoughts and intent of the heart. I don't think we will fully understand the power and the victory that God has made available to us until we get to heaven. Amen? He is an unbelievable and an impossible working God. Amen? He's a miracle worker. Do you believe that today? He's a miracle working God. I really want to encourage us to reach out beyond the boundaries of natural thinking, to burst out of religious and natural mindsets. These are the areas that we've got to work on. Religious and natural mindsets. Our mindsets that say it's impossible. And become more God-minded on the inside. On the inside, I'm talking about. See, Jesus, when he walked into that impossible situation in the natural, with all the people, the professional mourners were there, and all the negativity in that, Jesus knew what he carried. And he knew what the word of God that came out of his mouth carried. I believe it's for you and I to really find out what it carries. It carries the anointing. It carries the power of God. That when Jesus spoke these words, don't fear, don't be afraid, only believe, she will live. The moment that he spoke those words, it didn't matter what happened in the universe. It didn't matter what happened in the situation. But one of the things that Jesus did do before he raised that girl up was he drove out the unbelief. And I believe that that is our responsibility now, to allow the Spirit of God, the Word of God, the anointing of God. Friend, I want to tell you, the anointing is not just there to put doodads on you. It's not just there to make you feel good. It will challenge everything on the inside of you. When we really, 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 really come under the unction of the Holy Ghost, I want to tell you, there's going to be some weeping going on in the house of God. There's going to be some changes happening, amen. We see it in part, we see it, but I want to tell you, there's going to come a thing where the anointing will come in and it will challenge the unbelief that is in the church. Is it okay for me to talk like that? Or do you want me to just put cream on it? Hey? Is it okay to talk like that? You see, this is the answer that we've got to realize that when Jesus walked in there and he spoke those words, there was nothing. There was no demon. There was nothing that could stop it. The only thing that could stop it was the unbelief that was there. So he drove the unbelief out and he just took those that were with him and he brought them in and he talked to the little girl and he raised her up. The unbelief that is in my heart, in my life, in my thinking has to go. And you might look at me and say, oh, but you're the pastor. You don't have it. I have it. Every human has it. But it has to go. Amen. Has to go. Amen. It has to go. Because God wants it to go. And it's the anointing that will come in that will break it and smash that unbelief around our lives. We've got to understand the victory that God has given to us. I'm going to encourage you again, let me say it again, to reach out beyond the boundaries of your natural thinking and your natural ability, to bust out of religious and natural mindsets and become more God-minded on the inside. Greater is he that's within me than he that's within the world. Let your imagination loose. You know, a lot of religious people say you shouldn't do that. But God gave me an imagination. I sit sometimes in my dream time, in my alone time, and I just start to think, and I start to see thousands upon thousands. Yesterday we went to a music conference, and I was watching there, and I think I was the oldest person there. I don't think I would have been for sure. I was even older than the piano. But I was watching, and while I'm there watching, I'm looking at young men and young women out the front with their hands raised, and I allowed that to get into my dream time, hallelujah. And I see young people, I see people with their hands raised worshiping their God, hallelujah. I see the young people of the Sunshine Coast coming to Christ, amen. I saw one old fellow there, so I watched him too for a little bit. But I see people not just coming to church, but with their hands raised, with their hearts wide open, singing and dancing and praising their God and allowing the anointing of God to get around them, allowing the presence of God to get on the inside of them, amen, and change us forever. I want you to dream a dream. Dream a dream. If you're a worshiper or whatever it is, dream a dream of you standing in the presence of God and the anointing coming down and people all in the congregation weeping and allowing the anointing that you've actually helped bring down. Just see that. Release yourself, amen. If you're bound with something, see yourself dancing up the aisles, hallelujah. Dream. Because God wants to open up that river, that Red Sea, so you can walk right through it. Too many Christians are bound and afflicted because of inhibitions and goodness knows what else. Dream a dream. Dream a dream, hallelujah. Dream a dream. Let your imagination loose. Sit and dream about the God inside of you. This is God who created the universe with the word. I dream of seeing people jumping out of wheelchairs. I dream of seeing our sister get new feet. I dream of the impossible. Because I've got to dream about the impossible, amen? I don't want to dream about the possible. I want to dream about the impossible. Dream a dream. See people jumping out of wheelchairs. See drug addicts totally set free, amen. See the prostitutes worshiping their God, amen. Dream a dream. If you don't dream a dream, you just get idle. It's God who created the universe with a word that still today confuses all the wise. The most brilliant minds. I can see the disciples when they were with Jesus and Jesus started to display and manifest his power, his presence. You know what? Jesus, most of his miracles were just breaking the stronghold of natural thinking. Turn the water into wine. I put myself there with Peter. I walked there. I walk beside him. I stand with him. I watch him as he fills those pots up with water. I see him as he comes back and Jesus says, go and serve it. I think, my God, it's water. I filled it up. I know where it come from. It's water. But see, Peter and them learned, nevertheless, according to your word. See, the word is powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It's alive, it's living, it's what we need to get hold of. So he started to pour it. And as he poured it, he noticed it was no longer white, but now it's red. Or white, I don't know what color it was. Anyway. He saw the man, he thought, well, this is it. Oh, he said, you've kept the best to last. Hey, this is me. Hey, Jesus, how'd you do that? How did you do that? How did he do it? By his word. How is he going to heal you? By his word. How are you going to get new feet? By his word. How are you going to get delivered? By his word. How are you going to get set free? By his word. What he's done in the past, he'll do again. He's opened that river. I can't remember the line of them. I'm just ad-libbing it here. But I remember this bit, that we walk right through it. He split the sea. He split the sea. He split that negativity. He split that lie. He split that thing. He split it so you can walk right through it. and slap the devil up the side of the head as you go through. Whack! Cop that, you foul, filthy looking thing you are. Better put that back. Anybody getting anything out of this? I am. I preach to myself more than I ever preach to you. I preach this 10 times already today in my little office. Amen. Created a word today that confounds the most brilliant minds. I can see those disciples. How'd you do that? I believe it started to click in when I've preached about this before, and I know that I just want to use this as an example. And I believe that Jesus then and now, as we start to catch the drift, as we start to understand this walk of faith, as we start to understand what God says we can do, that we can do, as we start to understand it, I believe that Jesus gets real excited about that, amen. When we start believing that somebody's going to get new feet, amen. When we start believing that cancer is going to be destroyed, when we start to believe that people will be delivered, when we start to believe that drug addicts will be totally set free, when we start to believe that prostitutes will be mightily saved in Jesus' name, and that the Sunshine Coast will be a place where a haven for the things of God. It was a day there when Jesus was walking on the water. And as he walked there, and they were gratefully fearful, it says, and it says that he walked up, he said, "Don't be afraid, it's I." And when he walked close to the boat, Peter said these words. And I want to say these words with Jesus, with Peter. And I want this congregation of people to start saying these words. Jesus, bid me come, and I will walk on the water. Jesus, help me so I can break through this stronghold. My God, you're going to open the sea so I can walk right through it. That was a bit weak. I think it's better with it better. Better clap than that. Oh man, I don't preach for claps. I want to be that person. I want to be that person. I'm in the boat today and I'm reaching out. I'm saying, Jesus, come on, I want to walk on the water with you. I want to do what you did. I believe Jesus would have got so excited when Peter started saying that. Come out. I believe that Jesus wants every one of us to rise up, go out and preach the gospel. Can I tell you, the gospel is your story. Go and tell somebody your story. You don't have to open up your Bible to the book of Revelations and try to explain to somebody what the man-child is or what the rapture means or what this means or what that means. Just tell them your story. Amen. This is what happened to me. People are more interested in you than anything else. Tell your story. Jesus wants you to go out and tell your story to somebody. Amen. He wants you there to go and lay hands on the sick. He wants you to go and cast out devils in his name and see the miracle power manifested in your life. Why? Because God wants to give an opportunity for every person to meet his son. How did you get saved? You didn't find it in the Kellogg's cornflakes packet. Somebody would have come and spoken to you their story. How many people come to Christ because somebody told your story? Come on, give me a wave. Tell the truth, shame the devil. See, this. Go tell your story. Because Jesus, God wants everyone to meet his son, praise God. When confronted with the impossible, and you will. I would love to tell you today, you'll never have another impossible situation in front of you. But I want to tell you, when you face it, and you will, it's what you say and believe, that's what will set you free, amen. It may be impossible, but in Jesus' name, it will be done. Anybody here ever had an impossible situation in front of you? That today is no longer there? The moment I've got a coffee cart. But a couple of months ago, it was a boat. It's gone. You and I are made in God's image. And nothing is impossible with God and those who believe. So if you can believe that. Don't let the devil or anyone else convince you that you can't or never will. When I first got saved, my friends were really worried about me because Neil's got religion. And they tried everything they could to stop me from getting caught up in religion. But when I was young, the things that they were, the little attack was today is nothing but a pimple. It wouldn't have even, today, that what they were, that doesn't even concern me because you see, I am established now. I know whom I believe in. I know who I believe. Back there, I wasn't too sure whether I was up or down, Arthur or Martha. I don't know what happened. I just gave my life to Jesus and all of a sudden joy started to come into my life. I started to get happy. I still had a lot of sin in my life. I still had a lot of problems in my life. I still had things going on. And so I wouldn't have been too hard to have sideswayed. But you see what the Bible says, that he will not allow the devil to tempt you beyond your ability to resist. But today, it's a different story, amen? I can laugh at that now because I am established. I know who I believe in. I have been filled with the power of God. I've seen God heal. I've seen God deliver. I've seen God set people free. I've seen the miraculous. I know who I believe in. Hallelujah. But it's a different set of things now where the enemy comes at you. He will come at you. But when he comes at you, know who you are. Know who you are. Know who you are. If he does say you can't, you just tell him you can. Settle some things in your spirit. There's nothing you can't do. There's nothing that is impossible. Listen to this. So many people spend their lives trying to become something that they already are. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Is that true? We try to become somebody we already are. Friend, I'm a new creation. I'm a brand new man. I'm more than a conqueror. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Jesus has already done what is required on the cross to make you a child of God, more than a conqueror, etc., etc. Nike had a slogan, just do it. Just do it. I say, just accept it. God loves you and gave his life for you. Just accept it. Amen? I don't need to know the pedigree. I don't need to know why, how, when, what for. I just accept it. Amen? How many people just accept that? I just accept it. Just accept it. Nothing is impossible for you. Just accept it. Just accept it. You are healed by the stripes of Jesus. Just accept it. I hear most people who quote that scripture before their mouth is shut, have cursed themselves and destroyed the truth that was in that verse. Just accept it. You don't have to get all fluffy-ducky about it. You don't have to get all hyper-whatever. You don't have to fall over under the power. You don't have to do this. You don't have to do. You just have to accept it. I am healed. Hallelujah. They wanted to give me a flu shot. I said, I don't need a flu shot. You have a flu shot, God bless you. But for me, I don't have a flu shot. I don't need a flu shot. I've got Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Faith is not a fight to become something. It's an acceptance of who you already are. I believe it's time to trust God and give Him thanks. Amen. Here endeth the lesson. We serve a God who does the impossible. Amen. Why don't we stand up and give Him thanks? Just give Him thanks with a grateful heart. Give Him thanks today. Power of God is in this house, friends. God is on the throne. We serve a God who expects us to do the impossible because He's already done it for us. Don't try to become somebody you already are. Become that person by accepting it. I am a child of God. I carry the mantle and the anointing of God. All of us, we have an unction from the Holy Ghost. We have a purpose. We have a part in this mission. I just want you to come and stand in the presence of God. If God's talking to you today, you want to walk right through that thing. You want to walk right through it into the very throne room of God, into the very purpose and the plan of God, into the very anointing of God, into the victory of the cross of Calvary. You know the obstacle that stands in front of you. You've got to see Him split it wide open.